I want to talk to you this morning on part three of advancing through Ephesians. For those of you visiting with us for the first time, you perhaps have missed one or two. The link is on the Facebook page. You can go there and view the part one and part two. But this morning we consider part three of advancing through Ephesians as we pick up from Ephesians chapter 1, verse 15. Now, one of the first things I want to share with you in terms of this reading and what we're considering is when we get to this stage of Ephesians, Paul the Apostle starts talking about the faithfulness and the caring of the believers, how they were faithful and being faithful in studying and fellowshipping together. Their hearts were changed and they became caring. And this last week has been a rather busy week in terms of hospital visits. And I'm truly blessed to be able to go down and attend to the folks. But what I try and do is whenever I go to the hospital, I try and go during visiting hours. Now that sounds crazy because the ministers can go pretty much most of the time. But the reason why I go during visiting hours is I can visit with the family and we can have a prayer together. Now that's wonderful, but it comes with its own challenges. And one of the challenges is I have to move often between three hospitals within an hour. So I go down to Mercantile, and from Mercantile up to Green Acres, and from Green Acres down to St. George's. So therefore, the trick is to find parking. And it's during visiting hours. So what I've taken to do is I know the spots where the doctors park. So when I drive in and I see the doctor's bay is open, I park there. Now, that would be fine if I was driving a BMW or a Merc or something like that. You wouldn't notice. But when I arrive with my vehicle with Grace Church embedded on the doors, I give myself away. And lo and behold, there was a security gentleman that arrived with his little golf cart as I was pulling in. And he said, "Excuse me, sir, this place is only for doctors." And you've got to think quick when that thing happens, not so. And I looked and I said, "Yes, I know. Look, it says doctor." He says, "Yes, sir." I said, "But it doesn't say medical doctor. It says doctor, and I'm a soul doctor, so I'm coming now. I'm just in my car. I'm just going to bring some comfort to the souls of people." And I did not give him a chance to argue with me. He left there standing looking at me, and I walked away and went into the hospital. And by the time I came out, he was gone. So, so if at any stage I am arrested and placed in prison, you know why, impersonating a doctor, please do also then come and confirm the fact that I am a registered soul doctor here at Grace Church and that we do administer the gospel rather diligently on a Sunday. And so he left me alone, and I noticed out the corner of his eye, he was looking rather sheepishly at me when I drove away. So nonetheless, I share that with you, but those are some of the little anecdotes that we have. Then the other occasion was, I went down and I went to see a gentleman in one of the medical wards, and I walked in, sat down with his family, and the next minute I heard, "Hey, Germany, but Mark here." And there was somebody else that we saw and we prayed for, and then I just finished that, and I turned around, and there was somebody else from the church. And I looked and I thought, well, goodness gracious me, out of a ward of six people, three of them are from Grace Church. So I was very tempted to start a sermon. But nonetheless, I kept it for this week. So let's have a look. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 15. Paul the Apostle writes, he says, "Whereof I," that's Paul, "also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and the love unto all the saints, cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers." Notice, Paul writes in the very beginning of Ephesians, the book of advanced doctrine, where he's teaching these believers and he's writing to them and he's giving them some extra teaching that he's expanding on from his book that he wrote to the church in Rome. He writes in one of the first things, he says, "Whereof I also, after I heard of your faith," he had not been there, but he heard of their faithfulness. He heard of their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and the love unto all the saints. Their faith in Christ had driven them to be caring to one another. He then says, "I cease not to give thanks." Notice that. "I cease not to give thanks." making mention of you in my prayers. Folks, we are required, in terms of the scriptures, to never stop praying for one another, to never stop thanking the Lord for one another. Later on, you'll have a look in Ephesians, the book of Ephesians, as Paul writes and says, submitting yourselves to one another. We are to esteem each other higher than each other. We are to value each other. We are to value each other's souls so deeply. And therefore, Paul writes and he says, I thank my God. Ongoing prayer and thought is what he lifted up. Notice also in Colossians, he says, we give thanks to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you. Why? Since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and the love which you have to all the saints. Once again, the Colossian church were doing the same thing. Paul heard of this faithfulness of the Colossians from Epaphras. Epaphras came, who was in Ephesians and Ephesus, and he'd come to Paul and he said, you know what, I've been down to the Colossian church, and man, I'm going to see the faithfulness of those folks. And Paul says, wow, that's fantastic. Remember, there were no WhatsApp chat groups. There was no Skype. There was no telephones. There was no, I mean, they had to walk for days. Sometimes travel for weeks to get to one another. Can you imagine the excitement of Epaphras as he was, and when he went and he sought out Paul and he found Paul and he said, man, you must see the faithfulness of these people. And Paul says, well, tell me more. He says, well, you know what? They love the Lord and they have faith in Christ. But you know what they do? Their faith is not just a fickle faith. Their faith has driven their hearts to love one another and care for one another. Faith. True faith in the living Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, drives an agape, unconditional. That word agape is unconditional love. Let's have a look at what he says to the Thessalonians. In 1 Thessalonians 1, 2 and 3, he says, we give thanks to God always for you all, making mention of you in our prayers, remembering without ceasing your work of faith and labor of love and patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ, in the sight of God and our Father. These Thessalonians have faced a couple of challenges, and Paul commends them for their work of faith, being faithful in the work of the Lord, and their labor of love towards one another, and their patience. And they could be patient because they understood the hope that they had in Christ. And Paul commends them, and he says, because of your love in Christ, because of your study of the Word, your response is unconditional love. I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. In Galatians 3 says, O foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? These Galatians were Christians, brothers and sisters in Christ, but something had happened in that church. Notice, Ephesians, you never cease to give thanks. We thank the Lord for you and for your love. The Colossians, we thank the Lord for your love and your faithfulness and the love that you have for each other. The Thessalonians, without ceasing, we give thanks for your work of faith, your labor of love, and your patience of hope. The Galatians, I marvel that you are so soon removed. Folks, we are in a day and age today where many of the churches, if they had got a letter from the Apostle Paul, which one do you think they'd get? The Galatian letter. Why? Because in this modern society that we live, and in the self-centeredness that we live, over and over we find Christians. I'm not talking about non-believers now. We would expect that from non-believers. But Christians who are self-centered, not focused on caring for one another. And our challenge this morning is, which church are we? If Paul the Apostle had to write to us, well, I know what letter I'd write. I thank the Lord God. leaving my office just last week, who's not part of our church, who made an appointment to come and see me, to come and talk about you people. And he sat down and he said, "I will need for your sake, die to mense van hier, a so liefdevol, dierbare mense." And I said, "Pray tell me who they are so I can go visit them." No, I'm kidding. I said, "I know. I thank the Lord for you folk and your faithfulness." And you know what it is? It's God's Word through the Holy Spirit that dwells within you, and God's Word coming together and helping us see and understand the importance of knowing the true message of grace. The importance of looking at our own lives when you look in the mirror and you say, "Lord God, what is there that you want me to do today? What, God, can you use me for to bring your love and your care to the hearts and the lives of people?" And not, "Lord, you give me the strength and courage to go out there and let me fix the world for you." We ain't going to fix the world. But we're not going to preach the gospel. And the gospel is going to touch the hearts and the lives of people, and they're going to be drawn out of the world. The Lord Jesus Christ says, "For his sake, you will suffer persecution." Which means we're not going to be in the majority of folks. But that's good. Because it means that we have a lot of work to do. And we've got to get out there and share faithfulness of Christ. And I say the faithfulness of Christ because he was faithful to go to the cross of Calvary and faithfully do what the Lord had demanded, and that was to bring justice because of the sin of the world. To take upon himself that wrath. And we're going to be looking at that leading up to this Easter time. And we know and understand that it's the Easter weekend is no holier than the next weekend. But it's an opportunity for us to bring a focus on this. So I say to you, let us not allow Satan to infiltrate his worldly ways into our hearts and minds. Understand that the greatest manipulator, the one who has the greatest ability to make you waste time, is the enemy of your soul. Draw you with things that seem good, but are in actual fact wasteful. So if we come to this knowledge and this understanding of being faithful in the study of God's Word, faithful in carrying out what God wants us, we begin to become loved in the sense of bringing that love towards each other. And you know what happens? If I esteem you all higher than myself, and you esteem me, and we esteem each other, and we're like, we fight each other, no, you more important. No. You know what happens in our hearts? We have a mindset which is completely different to the world. Not one that says, "You trample who you can to make it in the world." Instead, let the Lord say, "You carry who you can to bring it to Christ." And when we do that, we begin to grow in the wisdom of God's Word. Paul writes in Ephesians 1:17, he says that he's just praised them for what they've done. And he says that the God of our Lord Jesus, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and the revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is that hope of his calling and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. That the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, folks, God the Father is the Father of glory. He's the one that's going to bring the glory. May give you the spirit of wisdom. Now, that spirit of wisdom is not sort of you walk in, sort of line up, and the Lord goes, shh, 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 Okay, you've got the spirit of wisdom. There you go. Off you go. Go do your work. The Holy Spirit lives within you. The Holy Spirit is the one that resides within your very spirit and your soul, envelops the entire life that you have if you would allow God to do that. And you get that through acknowledging what Jesus Christ did on the cross of Calvary. So how can Paul then say, may give you the spirit of wisdom? Well, the Spirit brings wisdom, but how can you get the spirit of wisdom? It is the mind of Christ. The mind and the understanding of what the Scriptures want you to know. And therefore, God, through the Holy Word, uses His written Word today, through the Holy Spirit living within you, to bring that enlightenment, that understanding, that you get the spirit of wisdom, you become wise. Why? Because you begin to understand the revelation of the knowledge of God's Word, and you begin to understand how God would want us to be doing things today. Not because you stand and say, Lord, show me. Open the door for me, Lord. Show me the open door. Folks, be careful. Some open doors can lead to empty elevator shafts. Be careful. Be careful. Don't go on a emotionally based, Lord, you show me. Lord, if the next three traffic lights are green, then I know you want me to sell this car. That's not how God operates. God says, you have my word. You study my word. 2 Timothy 2:15. 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. You study my word. You want to know my will, my truth. You want to know my will for your life. You study my word. You find out what I'm doing, and you do what I'm doing. And what is God doing? He's bringing the message of grace to people. Now, if you're driving a vehicle and the vehicle is old and it's giving you trouble, well then, your intellect's going to tell you, say, well, look, maybe it's time to sell this car and get a decent car. That's intellect. Or if I look at a vehicle and say, ooh, that's a very nice car. I mean, hang on a minute. Listen, I was going on feelings. I could come to you as a congregation and say, you know what? I find it very helpful parking in the doctor's parkings. But for me to park there and not be seen, I need a BMW. And I prayed to the Lord, and at all three hospitals that I went to yesterday, there was a parking bay at the doctor's bay. So therefore it's a sign that I need to get a BMW. And it can't be older than 3 years. I could do that, couldn't I? And can I tell you something? There are folks that use that kind of understanding. But then, if I think rationally and logically, I say, well, that would be a waste of money. That would be a waste of good funds that can be used to spread the gospel. I don't need a BMW. That's not what I'm talking about. Okay? It's got to do with logic. It's got to do with using the mind. Having the spirit of wisdom. Is it affordable? If it's affordable, by all means, go get it. But it's logic thinking, folks. Growing in wisdom is logic thinking. It's revealed through the knowledge of God's Word. Paul writes in Colossians, he says, for this cause, we also, since the day we heard it, did not cease to pray for you. He carries on with what we read earlier. And to desire that you may be filled with the knowledge of His will. Well, there we go. Hang on. To the Ephesians, he says, that you will have the spirit of wisdom and be filled with the spirit of wisdom. He brings a clarity to that in the Colossians. Writing where he says that you are full with the knowledge of His will. Just another way of saying being full with the spirit of wisdom. And how are you going to be full with the knowledge of His will? In all wisdom and spiritual
understanding.
How are you going to have spiritual understanding? By studying the scriptures. Why do you need this, the knowledge of God's will? Why do you need spiritual understanding? For what purpose?
That you may walk, that he, that's all of you, may walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God.
That's why you need spiritual understanding. That's why you need to be filled with his will. Why? So that ye, you believers, can walk worthy. That is not walking worthy to be one into heaven. It's walking worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing. Well, what pleasing is that?
Being fruitful in every good work.
How are you going to be fruitful in every good work for the Lord?
By knowing God's will.
And how are you going to know God's will?
2 Timothy 2:15, 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17.
All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine.
Doctrine is teaching. Doctrine is teaching, reproof, correction, and instruction in righteousness.
Folks, it's God's word that we need to turn to. Not some hocus-pocus thing out there that we say, Lord, show me a sign.
Philippians 3:20, Paul writes, and he says, for our conversation is in heaven. That word conversation means our citizenship, because in the old days you were known, it's like you're a South African, you speak English, but I know you're from Durban because of the way you speak English. Not so. Well, I'm not from Durban, but I can tell those who are from Durban because they just have a different way of speaking.
Our conversation is in heaven. Our citizenship is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile body, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto him. All things. God is able to subdue all things unto him. Folks, if we live in this world, what does the enemy want us?
The enemy wants us to feel alone.
The enemy wants us to feel defeated. But how are we going to know the will of God and the fact that we are not defeated? When we read the scriptures tell us that we are not defeated. The scriptures tell us that we have a hope which is beyond this world. And that's why Paul says to the Philippians that our citizenship is in heaven. Folks, that's where we live. That's our true residence. This is just temporary. This is just temporary. Colossians 1, 5 and 6 says, for the hope, that is the knowledge of absolute assurance, which is laid up for you in heaven, whereof ye have heard before, in the word of truth of the gospel. Where have you heard? The word of truth. What is the word of truth?
The Bible.
Which is coming to you, as it is in all the world, and bringeth forth fruit, as it doth also in you. Since the day ye heard of it, and knew the grace of God, notice, in truth. You knew of the grace of God, but you knew of it in truth. Somebody shared it with you. And then what do? You go read about it. You go find out. Don't trust what I'm saying to you. And say, well, you know, it's got to be like that because Abel says that.
No.
Because I could mislead you. I could get you whipped up and win your trust and then lead you down the wrong path. But if we give the scriptures the opportunity of teaching us, and you look at the scriptures, and I give you the scriptures, and you go home and you take the scriptures, and you read the scriptures, and you say, like a faithful Berean, as in Acts 17, you go and you search. And for those on the video, if you're watching the video, you search the scriptures. And if you find in the scriptures that you disagree with me on anything, I'm looking at the video right now, then you contact us. Put on a pot of coffee and get your Bible. And then we'll
Don't come with I think this and I think that. Come with the scripture tells me this and the scripture tells me that. Then I'm going to listen. Acts chapter 20, verse 27. Paul says, "For I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. Take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers, to feed the church of God which he hath purchased with his own blood." Folks, let me tell you, it is a daunting task to be a pastor. It is a daunting task to be an elder, someone who has leadership in the church. It is not a task to walk around all puffed up and say, "Oh, look at me." Because that scripture tells me that I have a responsibility which is massive. And the only way that I can fulfill this responsibility is to study God's word and bring God's word to you. Do you know, and I will share some of this in my report with the annual congregational members meeting. Do you know that I am required, if I'm going to share God's word with you, and I'm going to share the truth of God's word with you, to spend a minimum of 20 hours a week in God's word? You agree? Well, how would you like your doctor to creep his way through varsity and then have your life in his hands and say, "Well, which one is it now?" No. Doctor, did you put in the hours? Doctor, do you still put in the hours? You're going to ask any medical doctor that's worth his salt how much reading he does in a week. Continue updating himself. And I commit myself to that. It's vital, it's important. But that doesn't mean I can neglect my practical duties either. And therefore, it is a daunting task, but at the same time, there is nothing else that I would want to be doing. Because the more I read God's word, the more I see in God's word the truth of God, and the beautiful price that Christ paid for your soul. And I say beautiful because it is absolutely diabolical what he went through. But the measure of his love was shown at his weakest time in hell. Why? Because we worship a God who is above all powers. Ephesians 1, 19 and 20. "And what is the exceeding greatness of his power to us who believe?" Notice, there is exceeding greatness of power to us. But it's only to believe. Because if you don't believe, you're not going to get that. "According to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his right hand in heavenly places." Romans 1:16, Paul says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation." Power. It's not just, "Oh Jesus, you're so nice, you did this for me." It's the power of God. It's the power that we have to know and understand. Why? It's the power unto salvation. To who? To everyone that believeth. Everyone. Yes? Your neighbor that gives you issues, if he believes in the Lord Jesus Christ, to him too. Paul says to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Why? Because he went first to the Jews because that is what he proclaimed. And when they rejected, he said, "Well, now it's to everyone." That's what Paul declares. In Ephesians 1, 21 to 23, he says, "Far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named." He said, far above. You think of a height.
You know, like you're driving to Cape Town, you fill the car up, and you know your car can get 822 kilometers on a tank. And at 815, you think to yourself, how am I going to do this? Because there's 20 k's to the next petrol station. Or you look at it and you say, oh, no, there's a lot of time. It's not that time, is it? It's like you driving to Cape Town, and behind you is an engine vehicle filled with 50,000 liters of fuel, and behind it, another 100. Just to fuel your car. And you say, that's crazy! That's overkill! And that doesn't even come close to what God has done. Folks, God hasn't just scraped through to give you what He's given. He's above all. He's above creation. He's above everything you could begin to imagine. That's the God you serve. He's not the Avengers. He's not Superman. He's Almighty God. Above all things. Understand. Get that into our, we have to get that into our frame of reference. And when we begin to see this God that we worship, and we walk out of there, and people want to make us feel insignificant and useless, you just know, man, you've got God on your side. There's a video clip of a young bear that's running, and he gets chased by a cougar or something, and he's running, this tiny little guy, and he turns around, and he's got this like tiny little growl, and he gets to a point, and he turns, and he faces, and he's backed up, and he looks, and he faces this thing, and he growls, and next thing, this cougar takes off, and then the shot is wider, and you see behind him is his mother, and that cougar takes off. Well, I want to tell you, if that was God, you'd have the entire population of bears behind that little guy. And that still wouldn't match up to Almighty God. Folks, begin to understand the God that you worship. Far above all principality and power, and might and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. And have put all things under his feet, and gave to him to be the head over all things, to the church, which is his body, that's us, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. Folks, do you understand the glorious God we worship? As you sit here this morning, can you begin to see and understand a little bit more of the magnitude of God? So the next time you go and you buy a burger and you ask no garnish, and they put a garnish on it, take the garnish off. You don't have to go shout at the guy. The next time somebody cuts into you, slap off. Save your heart. Save your blood pressure. Slack off. Say, God, thank you that I could see this person turning. After all, it may just be me that cuts in front of you. Colossians 2:10. We end with this. And ye, that word ye, we've said before, is Paul, when he says that in the Greek, the English word ye there means all of you, all believers, and ye are completing him, which is the head of all principality and power. Folks, you are complete in Christ. There is no issue, physical, financial, emotional, that is bigger than what God cannot help you. God is so big, so powerful, and so mighty, He doesn't have to take stuff away out of your way. He gives you the strength and the courage to go through it. That's a powerful God. That's a powerful God. The whole world is talking about the Parliament of the United Kingdom that was invaded by terrorists.
those families that have lost loved ones. It's tragic. But folks, the whole world is invaded by a power that the world is giving power to annihilate souls of people. And the world stands idle, but not you. Why? Because you have the Holy Spirit living within you. Every believer has the Holy Spirit living within them. And the time, folks, is now that we have to begin to stand up and be counted and be believers who live out a message of grace and a message of love and care. Why? Because God has done all for us. Let us be people who are less self-focused and more focused on others. And you're only going to be able to do that if you know that your challenges are taken care of. The bank can repossess your car, but no one can take the soul. It's tough, folks. The world we live in today, it is tough financially. It is tough emotionally. But nothing is impossible to get through without God, with God's help. So my challenge is, for me, Lord, help me focus every single day. For me, I put it in Acts 20, 27 to 28, is that verse, I put it in for me specifically to remind me this morning as I'm speaking to you that the task that I have is such a vital one. And I ask you to pray for me, that I can have boldness to declare the message of grace. And I will pray for you, that you may have boldness to live out the message of grace. We pray for one another. And let Grace Church truly live up to its name. That we, members and adherents, proclaim and live out the grace of God. God bless you, people. Let us pray. Father God, we give you thanks and praise this morning for your goodness, your grace, and your mercy. Lord, and as we come to understand this morning a little bit more of your word, Father God, we come to you as a body of believers this morning, as we collectively gather. Lord, help us to be conscious of the people around us. Lord, we may not even know each other. We may not even know the circumstances in each other's lives. But Lord, help us see the value of each and every soul here this morning. And then as a collective body of believers, help us reach out and do the things which are practically necessary, but never forsaking the important spiritual aspect of life, that we come to your word and read it, study it, and allow it to impact our soul in such a mighty way. We thank you for this in Christ's name. Amen.